All right, well, welcome back to the Best Facts Apologetics Answers show. We've been interviewing Grant Brissett. We've asked him some great questions about evangelism and apologetics during our past videos. And if you missed those, get them on our YouTube channel. In some of those interviews, the topic of discussing our faith with Jehovah's Witnesses and Mormons came up. Grant, I know you do this all the time, so my question to you today is, how can a Christian share the good news of salvation in Jesus Christ alone with Jehovah's Witnesses and Mormons?
Oh my gosh, Nate, thanks for asking that. You're gonna have to stop me because I can go on with this one. But it's kind of a side hobby, and I just want to challenge Christians to consider more discussions with Mormons and Jehovah's Witnesses. The first thing it's going to do is it's going to challenge you. The good news is you know Christ, know your gospel. The bad news is you don't have answers for everything, and I just want you to relax in that. If you are solid in your faith and you're comfortable with witnessing to people who are not Christians, Mormons and Jehovah's Witnesses are great people to, and I'm going to say practice on. We love Mormons and Jehovah's Witnesses. We want to reach them as individuals, but they will train you and hone your skills by challenging you. That's one of the first things. So if you're comfortable, I'm going to recommend if you have never talked to a Mormon or Jehovah's Witness, here's some possible ways you can do that. First, just be nice to them. Just talk, just chit chat. They are going to be very nice to you, and they're going to want to witness to you. So if you're nice, they're going to keep talking to you, or they're going to have multiple conversations with you. And so all you have to do at the beginning is simply ask questions. And you can ask them, hey, what's your understanding of the gospel? What's your understanding of what the Bible teaches? And what that does is, like Greg Kokel teaches, right? Some tactics on having in conversation is it gets you out of the hot seat for a minute, and you don't have to be worried about having all the answers or the perfect thing to say. So put the ball in their court and simply ask them, what do you think the gospel is? What's your understanding? In other words, let them do what they want to do. Their goal is to give you the spiel. Now, not only will it make you feel like you have a little minute to breathe and relax, but it'll also teach you what they believe. We sometimes make the mistake, maybe let's just say I sometimes make the mistake of thinking Mormons and Jehovah's Witnesses believe all the same thing because I read some books and have talked to prior people. That is not true. I've talked to Mormons that believe, and lately this is what they're saying, we are going to progress into becoming a God. They believe God is an office, not one being, the way the Bible teaches. I sat next to a Mormon on a plane one time and asked her that. She said, no way, I don't believe that. I've never been taught that in my life. So what I tell Mormons is, in my experience, I decided not to become a Mormon, but I am a Christian. I'm willing to listen to you, and I wouldn't mind comparing what I understand to what you understand. And if it makes sense, I'll continue to listen. And they love that. They love that. So if I'm just quiet, listen to their story. Here's what I've discovered. Mormons do not know the gospel. Mormons are saying words like Jesus, words like God, words like gospel. It is nothing like the biblical gospel. They are taking the same words we use and pouring completely different meanings in them. And so the first thing is let them give what they say the gospel is. And I've gone down to their church and sat there for an hour, and I have pictures of their drawings on the whiteboard, and they'll draw it out for you. They're trained to do it. And I do that first, the first time. And I don't even challenge them. I say, can I just go home and think about this and compare what I think? And then we talk later. And they're absolutely overjoyed to do that because they're trying to evangelize to you. So let me go back to the beginning here. The very first thing, let them share what they understand the truth to be. And then ask them, hey, can we talk again? And that will give you time to consider, to call, to read something, and figure out your response. But it will challenge you because now you need to know what the difference is. And you can even just go back and ask more questions. Here's what's going to happen. You're going to find that the gospel is completely different. They believe we had a pre-existence. the fall was a good thing because we got a physical body. This is Mormonism now. And we're going to progress to a spirit prison where if we die without accepting Mormonism, we'll get another chance. And from there, we will go to one of three kingdoms. We have the opportunity, if we follow the ultimate path, to become gods. The men have a opportunity to become gods, have another planet, and have future children that will fall just like we have on Earth here. And so I think just even throwing that out there, you can see there's all kinds of problems with that. And what I do, I've done this with three different missionary groups in the last couple months, is I've listened, I go home and I come back, and I don't even get confrontational. I say, let me just verbalize the difference between what you're saying is Mormonism and what the Bible teaches. And I simply discuss the fact that God gives us one opportunity to accept and reject his love, and then we have, with him or without him, heaven or hell, forever. There is no second chance. There is no progression to godhood. Man will never become God. That is actually a temptation from the Garden of Eden, that we become like gods, right? That's a temptation. And so, as you can see, I think it's not that difficult once you hear what they say, take some notes, take a picture with your phone, go home. I think you can do your own comparison, and that alone is going to start challenging you. Now, notice I didn't mention giving testimony the first time. I'm not saying you can't do that. I've done that way. You're welcome to give your testimony the first time. You're welcome to give testimony and evidence and go through that your first time. 100% up to you. The reason I have backed off that on my first encounter with Mormons and Jehovah's Witnesses is they're used to a Christian being confrontational at first, and you end up getting into what I call verse slinging and verse battles. And so I want to diffuse the situation by just listening, by just respecting them and honoring them, and realizing a Mormon or Jehovah's Witness is more difficult to witness to, because normally they're not coming at it from an open position. They're coming at it from a position to teach you. And now you have a challenge, in my opinion, to ask pertinent questions, give them the comparisons. And here's the last and biggest point I'll make. I don't want to destroy the faith of a Mormon or destroy the faith of Jehovah's Witness. I want them to meet the real Christ. I want them to know Christ. And so when I talk about the argument for the resurrection, and they're in on that full, I talk about the evidence for the Bible, the evidence for God's love for us. Then later on, I'm going to talk about what is the evidence for Mormonism in the Book of Mormon. And there turns out not to be very good evidence. I want them to accept Christ. I don't want to just crush their belief in Mormonism. I think that's a really important goal that we need to take on. What do you think, Nate?
Hey, I'm thankful that you brought up tactics and you're demonstrating that. Greg Kokel would be proud. We do need to engage with them, like you said, and ask those questions and hear them out. It is easy to come in guns blazing. That's oftentimes my approach, especially when I don't have a lot of time. And I have seen how sometimes they just shut down and that's the end of the conversation. So I'm thankful for your approach, and I'm glad to learn from that. Hey, for our listeners right now, I just want to encourage you with a fundamental that both Mormons and Jehovah's Witnesses get wrong, and that's the Trinity. The best analogy for the Trinity that I know is a room. Grant, you are in one room. I am in one room. But each of these rooms that we are in, even though they are only one room, they have three essential attributes: height, length, width. If you take away any of those three attributes, the room is no longer a room. If you take away height, it's just a floor. If you take away width, it's just a wall. So you have to have these three different parts to make one essence, a room. And it's just like that with the Trinity. And the Trinity is clearly described in Scripture. We see divine passages that clearly describe the Trinity and the deity of Christ and the deity of the Holy Spirit. We see Jesus's own divine pronouncements, calling himself the Lord of the harvest and things like that. We see divine prophecies, like in Zechariah 11, Jesus, we know, was betrayed for 30 pieces of silver, but in Zechariah 11, Yahweh God says that he was betrayed for 30 pieces of silver. You could go on and on, but I want to assure you that Jesus is God, the Holy Spirit is God, the Father is God, and the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit together are one God, the Trinity. That's important for you to understand in your conversations with Jehovah's Witnesses, Mormons, Muslims, and so many others. Grant, I'm thankful for your example of patiently encouraging Mormons and Jehovah's Witnesses towards the one true God. Hey, thanks so much for answering a few questions in these last videos. For all you watching, if you missed any of my last questions with Grant, you can get all those videos on our YouTube channel. I hope that you'll check those out. Well, Grant, it's been great having you. I look forward to having you back in the studio very soon.